This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, folks, every once in a while, I get something in here so mind-bending that my mind is bent. And to bend my mind after all these years of all these incredible experiences I've had and all the stories I've been told, and I've been told a few, that is something. We are going to be talking today about the lost Templar treasure, secret diaries, coded maps, and the Knights of the Golden Circle. And before you say, ho-hum, we've heard all that before, you have not heard this, because this is about the famous American outlaw Jesse James and the lost Templar treasure. And we are talking to Jesse's great-great-grandson, Daniel J. Duke. Daniel, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you. I'm honored to be here.
Well, it's wonderful to have you here. I have to tell you, you really surprised me. I had no idea about any of this. So let's start with your great-great-grandfather and his life. And folks, we're going to go down an amazing path today. This is going to be absolutely fun and absolutely fascinating. And I want to warn you in advance, don't try to go to Victoria Peak. We'll find out about Victoria Peak and why that is later on in the show. But tell us a little bit about your great-grandfather. Remind us of what he did during the Civil War and shortly after. And then we'll get into what really happened.
Okay. Well, when the Civil War started, Jesse James was a young man, you know, teenager, and his brother Frank had already gone off to fight with the Confederacy, and Jesse was too young, so he stayed home. He was on the farm. A group of guerrillas, Union-backed guerrillas, came onto their farm and beat him severely. So, you know, they strapped him to a plow and just beat him bad. And then they rode on to the farmhouse and beat his mother, who was pregnant at the time, and his stepfather. When he finally made it to the house, his mother had, you know, she'd been pushed around a lot, and his stepfather was hung from a tree. And they cut him down, saved his life. But he'd had brain damage from oxygen deprivation for the rest of his life. After that, you know, Jesse understandably was furious. He wanted revenge, and he found an outlet that would allow him that through Quantrell's guerrillas. And he joined them, and that's when his career, that's when I guess, you know, all of his training and for his outlaw career in later years began. I also think, well, after that, you know, the Civil War ended. None of the guerrillas were granted amnesty like the regular Confederate soldiers were. So if they were found, they were executed. Or if they turned themselves in, they were executed. So they didn't really have much of a choice. And that's what led into Jesse and the Youngers and his gang becoming outlaws. It was either hide and eventually get caught or fight back. So they fought. The war really never ended for them for years.
So they just kept on fighting, and Jesse soon became an absolute byword in American history. One of the early really popular outlaws. What made him so popular?
I think that he had a reputation. He didn't go around just robbing anybody. He had a reputation for he robbed, you know, fighting the railroads, and he robbed banks. A lot of the banks at the time were controlled by, you know, people asked, well, if he were Southern, why was he robbing so many Southern banks? Well, at the time it was during Reconstruction, when Northern bankers had come down after the Civil War and they were running the banks, so a lot of people resented that, and, you know, that's he wasn't robbing Southerners, he was robbing Northerners who were controlling Southern banks and interests, apparently. Also robbing the railroads. A lot of people had a grudge against the railroads, and he was, you know, they viewed Jesse as fighting the poor man's fight, in a sense. Other people viewed him as a crazy killer. But I think John Newman Edwards, back in the day, he was a newspaper man. He sided with Jesse and the James gang in the papers and basically worked as a PR for the James gang. So that helped push his Robin Hood identity, I guess globally at the time.
So he was a really legendary figure in his own time, both for good and for bad. And then Robert Ford, who he knew, did something, or did he? What happened there?
Well, traditional history records that Bob and Charlie Ford were working undercover for the governor of Missouri to put an end to Jesse James, one way or the other. And according to traditional history, in St. Joseph, Missouri in 1882, Jesse had taken off his gun belt, got on a chair to dust a picture on the wall, and they shot him in the back of the head. And that was supposedly the end of Jesse James. But my family story goes, tells a completely different story about that.
I'll say, folks, get ready for this, because this is going to surprise you. It's going to really surprise you. So tell us a little bit now about your mama.
All right. My mother, she passed away in 2015. Her name was Betty Dorsett Duke. For all her life, she grew up hearing that Jesse James was her great-grandfather. And, all the other cousins and relatives had heard the same thing. It was a family. It was just passed on in the family. Well, growing up, hearing that, and then later on, and then you see the history books and the historical statement, she would question which was true. Was history right, or was the family legend right? And she wanted to find out once and for all. And after 20 years of research and 3 books, she proved that Jesse actually faked his death and didn't die in 1882. So, she took a lot of family photographs to 3 separate forensic experts who verified that our family photographs matched Jesse and his known family members.
So, okay, well, go ahead.
Okay. Well, she took them to the Texas Department of Public Safety, which is our version of the state police, Austin Police Department's photographic forensic lab, and to a company called Visionics, who at the time were world leaders in facial recognition technology, until they were purchased by another company called Identix. 3 separate groups, none of them paid, all highly qualified experts in their field, and they all verified that our photos matched the known photos of Jesse and some of his family members. That started, that was the big break. And then through years of research, going through, every book we could find, all and state and federal records, different sources, word of mouth, and verifying that with actual records, everything lined up. But one of her biggest accomplishments at the time was the James Farman Museum and people who championed the historical version would say they had proof when they exhumed the grave in 1995 and tested the DNA. They used the DNA in 1995 as their proof that Jesse did die in 1882. Well, my mother destroyed that whole story for them. Not out of maliciousness. She just wanted to check their story just like they checked our story.
And tell us a little bit about your mother as a person. It was very interesting reading in the book about just what kind of a human being she was, because we're going to get into a pretty ugly little controversy here in a minute, but go ahead.
Okay, she was a real nice lady. Of course, she was my mother, so I'm going to think that.
Well, yeah.
I'm biased.
But there was something about her her honesty, was it?
She was very honest.
Very honest woman,
I mean,
yeah.
She was honest to a fault in a lot of, you know, some people would say. If you asked her a question, she'd tell you the answer. And if you got mad, she'd tell you, well, then don't ask me questions.
So. Right.
But she, you know, she was very caring, very loyal. She was a great mom, but she was a very honest person, and she was determined. When she got on a trail or had any goal, she went for it.
What originally made her decide to look into this at all?
When we I was in college. I think my little sister and my brother got out of high school. They were in college. Mom didn't have as much on her hands, and I remember a great aunt of ours handed her one of Grandpa's treasure maps and said, "Here's something you can check into," and that's what got her on, you know, kind of helped push her in that direction.
So she basically began to think that maybe there was something else here. Now, did she ever know your great grandfather? Did she ever actually meet him?
She never met him, but her older brother Wayne had, when he was an infant, Jesse had held Wayne on his lap, and then a few years later, Jesse had passed away. It was in 1943 when he passed away.
Now, where did he live, and what was his life like? Because he lived, I mean, he was supposed to have been dead, and he lived to 1943.
He lived in Blevins, Texas. It was originally called Buttermilk, Texas, and they changed the name later on, but it's about 30 miles south of Waco, and he lived under the alias of James Lafayette Courtney. And he lived a peaceful life after he had changed his name, and after he faked his death, he lived a peaceful life on his farm. As a 160-acre farm, and just lived a peaceful life until his death in 1943.
You know, Robert Ford took quite a hit for him because he became a notoriously despised man.
Yes, he did. There's a lot of questions I have regarding whether Robert Ford knew what he was doing. You know, was he helping him on purpose? Or did he get tricked?
Did he get tricked? Exactly. Did he think he'd killed him?
Yeah.
Now, let's get into a little bit more deeply the why of this. Why was your mother so sure that she would defy the Jesse James Museum's claims to the point of even danger? Let's talk about the things that made her so sure. But before we do that, folks, free Dreamlanders, listen up. You don't want to listen up anymore. I don't blame you. I wouldn't either. All you have to do is subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Go to the website and subscribe. It's easy. You can use PayPal. You can use your credit card. You can cancel anytime you want right in your own account. So it's easy, it's fun, and it will open up a whole new world for you. We'll be right back. I'll be at the Portal to Ascension Conference October 4th through the 6th at the Atrium Hotel in Irvine, California. It's www.ascensionconference to find out more. I'll be talking about my new book, A New World, about communicating with the visitors for the first time at that conference. There will be 27 other speakers, including Alan Seinfeld, Barbara Lamb, Travis Walton, and many, many others. Don't miss it. It will be the first time I talk about the new book, and as I attend so very few conferences, one of the only times. PortalToAscension.com.
Ever wonder what the Close Encounter experience is all about? Think you know what it's about? When you open Whitley and Ann Strieber's Immortal Communion Letters, you're going to experience a whole new vision. Not something being told to us by researchers and theorists, but the actual testimony of people who came face to face with this unknown. Unforgettable. And the book is only $3.99 at Strieber.com.
Listen to some words from one of our longtime subscribers.
As a subscriber of Dreamland for many years, it's been an incredible adventure and truly a Rosetta Stone for so many of the experiences that all of your listeners have had. Please join us. It's a fantastic ride. But I will say that certainly Dreamland does reflect something that I've always known, that man's mind mirrors a universe that mirrors man's mind. And no other place will you get this truth than on Dreamland. Come join us.
Some of the most thrilling, mind-opening interviews ever recorded are in the Dreamland Archive. Open your mind to Sir Lawrence Gardner's brilliant vision of the past. Listen to Russell Targ's phenomenal insights about ESP. Be inspired by Dr. Eben Alexander's stunning near-death experience. Listen to an actual recording from a plane as it was attacked by a gigantic flying disc. Be transported to a new level of inner grace with Whitley Strieber's meditations. Enjoy The Communion, Transformation, Majestic, Secret School, and Superstorm audiobooks, and so much more. The UnknownCountry.com subscriber section. As little as 10 cents a day. Priceless. War Day changed the way we think about nuclear war. Communion led millions to realize that they had encountered the visitors. Superstorm gave a word to the world that has become the byword of our time. The Key is among the most prophetic books ever written. And where can you get inside the mind that created all this? On UnknownCountry.com, where Whitley's life stories, his powerful meditations, his books, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, and others are available in audio format, and so much more exclusive Whitley Strieber material. Join Whitley on the path to tomorrow. How? Subscribe to UnknownCountry.com today.
We're talking to Daniel Duke, Jesse James and the Lost Templar Treasure, and we're going to get into that amazing story of this treasure shortly. But before that, we're trying to set the scene because we've just been told that Jesse James didn't die. He wasn't assassinated. He died in Texas in 1943. And beyond that, there is a huge, extraordinary story of one of the world's greatest lost treasures. But before we go down that path, why was your mother so certain that James L. Courtney of Blevins, Texas, was actually Jesse James?
Well, the photographs that she had verified were, that was a huge driver. It was proof, photographic proof that he was Jesse James. And then all the records she had gathered over the years, state and federal records, the diary, we had in our possession one of his diaries which ranged from 1871 to 1876, in which he mentions a lot of different gang members, known James gang members. All the evidence, it was so much evidence coming in, it just all pointed that way. And, when you've got that, the evidence backing up what you've been told all your life, and, there was no reason to back off the story. And it just pushed her further into wanting to know why they thought he died in 1882. And even by the time of her second book, she had more proof and evidence showing that, yes, James L. Courtney was actually Jesse James than they did. She had more proof that he was Jesse James than they did.
Yeah, and what was her proof?
Oh, well, the photographic evidence.
The photographic evidence. And was there eventually any DNA evidence or anything?
The DNA is worse. My sister and I are still working on that. The DNA was so convoluted and messed up. Not the DNA itself, but the just trying to get good DNA. Their 1995 exhumation that they did in Kearney, Missouri, when they claimed to exhumed the grave of Jesse James, was just, in the words of a former Clay County official, was like a tawdry sideshow. They dug up, I believe, the wrong grave. The grave they did exhume had a even had like a a woman's bones in it, and part of, you know, some of her clothing. So whose grave was it? No, they didn't even get any DNA out of that grave that they could use anyway, or that they wanted to use. And then when they did get DNA, they had to go through, there was a tooth and some hair that were at the James Farman Museum. The professor, who was a law professor, he wasn't even a doctor or a forensic scientist. He was the one who headed up the whole thing. Professor James Starrs was his name. He got a court order to get the hair and the tooth from the James Farm to test that. And they claimed they got DNA from the tooth and that, you know, that proved their story. Well, the man who was holding the hair that they also tested and backed up their story with, his name, he was a Clay County official named Stephen Caruso. He's also an attorney. He told my mother and I face to face that that was a tawdry sideshow, and he's even on record on the news as saying that. The hair that they tested, he had in his possession. He was protecting it. He didn't like the way they were running the whole thing, so when he was ordered to hand over the hair, he pulled the hair out of his friend's head, John Hartman, who was I think he was a director of Clay County Parks at the time, and they used that hair for testing, John Hartman's, not a hair from the museum. So the tooth that they claim they got the DNA from, that was from the original grave in the James family in their front yard of Jesse James' old home. They got the tooth out of that, but they never mentioned that along with that tooth were other human and animal bones, hog tooth, a dog's tooth, and a couple of human teeth, but whose teeth were they? There's no proof as to whose teeth they were. They could have been anybody's.
Yeah, and so it didn't really amount to anything.
Exactly.
Now, the museum and your mom got into quite a battle, didn't they?
Oh, yes. We were expecting, you know, a calm-headed exchange or debate, but they got real nasty real quick. And at first, you know, they were kind of rude from the get-go, and it just escalated from there, especially online.
When you say what happened,
well, it was little groups of people who kept changing their name. It went from debating history to. They would come out and insult you, a couple times there were little veiled threats here and there, and then it just went. In the end, the FBI got involved because they were sending my mother death threats. And thankfully for that, you know, we were very grateful to the FBI for taking care of that situation.
Well, you know, that's incredible that they would be so adamant about it. Do you have any explanation for what might have motivated them?
They would have to answer that. The only thing I could think was maybe it had to do with money. I don't know. I've never seen anybody act like that before. I expected more professionalism from people who claimed to be historians, and it was a lot worse than I thought it would get.
Yeah, you'd think. I mean, when you say money, what they were afraid of maybe would be that if this came out, the museum would die.
Yeah, and what my mother, I never understood why they would worry about that. I mean, that Jesse was born there and he was raised there. He just didn't die there. So I don't understand why they worried so much about that. I think tourists would have still been interested in visiting.
Yeah, it's very, very strange, but it happened. And in a few minutes, we're going to be going deeper into the issue of Jesse James and the Lost Templar Treasure, because it's an amazing story about an American outlaw and, to some people, an American hero who had a hidden life long after he was supposed to be dead, and truly extraordinary things happened during that life, and he left some fascinating clues. The book, Jesse James and the Lost Templar Treasure, Secret Diaries, Coded Maps, and the Knights of the Golden Circle, is terrific. Daniel Duke is the author, and I really seriously urge you to get it. Talk about great summer reading. What fun. And there's actually a lot of places you could go and things you could do after reading this book to look, to follow this wonderful story. We'll be right back. I'll be at the Portal to Ascension Conference October 4th through the 6th at the Atrium Hotel in Irvine, California. It's www.ascensionconference to find out more. I'll be talking about my new book, A New World, about communicating with the visitors for the first time at that conference. There will be 27 other speakers, including Alan Seinfeld, Barbara Lamb, Travis Walton, and many, many others. Don't miss it. It will be the first time I talk about the new book, and as I attend so very few conferences, one of the only times. PortalToAscension.com.
Where do you find Eben Alexander, Dean Radin, Jim Mars, Joseph Farrell, Zechariah Sitchin, William Henry, George Noory, Lawrence Gardner, Trish and Rob McGregor, Marie D. Jones, Marla Fries, Peter Lavenda, Richard Dolan, Starfire Tour, Linda Moulton Howe, and hundreds of others all telling you their deepest secrets? In the Dreamland Archive on UnknownCountry.com. All yours for under $5 a month. Go to UnknownCountry.com and subscribe today. Hours of listening pleasure. Expect to be amazed.
We're talking to Dan Duke about his terrific book, Jesse James and the Lost Templar Treasure. Loads of fun. Great summer reading. Just about as good as you can get, in my opinion. His website is authordanduke.com. That's authordanduke.com. You can go there to find out more about the book. And hey, you can even buy it there. You can buy it through us on the unknowncountry.com website and the Dreamland show page. Any number of those things are possible. So do get it. It's really worth it. Now, let's get back to Jesse, to James Courtney, to your mom, and to the Templar treasure. Now, can you let's go back to the whole beginning of this treasure issue. As the Civil War wound down and it was clear that the Confederacy was going to lose, there was a lot of treasure buried. Is that correct?
That's true.
Well, tell us a little bit about that and how you know that.
Well, former wealthy farmers and plantation owners and different people in the South had, you know, there was no place, no safe place to keep their money, even during the war. So a lot of them buried their money. Those who didn't flee the country, and there weren't many who fled. There was a group who fled to South America, mostly Brazil, and they were known as the Confederados. I always liked reading about them. But anyway, a lot of gold was buried and hoarded away, but there was also a group, a secret group, called the Knights of the Golden Circle. And some have said they were a small group. Others claim they had global ties and they were very powerful and subversive, a group of spies. But regardless, they were pro-Confederacy. They did have spies there during the war. Their goals were to try to hinder the Union Army movements as much as they could and to gather as much wealth and intelligence as they could. After the war, their stated goals were to refund a second Civil War. And, you know, that got the backing of a lot of people in the South, people who had fought. And I always viewed that as, a Friday night football game. You've got two rivals playing their hearts out. One loses, and they wish more than anything they could have another shot. And I think that's the same mentality, only on a much more important and dramatic level, with the South. after the war, any war, but after it ended, a lot of them wanted to fight another. So the KGC was said to have buried a lot of gold and just big, large caches of gold in different places around Canada, the U.S., and Mexico. And that's what, at first, I had believed the treasures belonged to. You know, if he had a treasure, they claimed that Jesse and Albert Pike were also members of the KGC. But I've found no proof of that. I've just, you know, there's a lot of people that claim it.
Yeah, but you can't be sure of that. All of us Southerners, and I come from a Southern family too, have many, many stories of what happened after the war and who did what and who went where. And some members of my family gathered up all of their wealth and went to France and simply disappeared from life. We'd entirely lost track of them. All I have left is a gold watch, a beautiful, perfectly beautiful gold watch that was owned by one of them, which was left behind as a memento that they would be remembered.
Wow.
So, you know, it was quite a time. Now, let's get into this remarkable story a little bit more about the Templar treasure itself. On your website, there is a quote from William Mann, who is a Dreamlander. He's been on Dreamland twice, I think. And you can, subscribers, if you're interested in listening to his absolutely fascinating stories, go to the search engine. Don't go down to the Dreamland podcast, because that part of it's not working yet. As you know, the website's still very new. But just search on the name William F. Mann. And he was the author of Knights Templar in the New World, The Templar Meridian, Templar Sanctuaries in North America. He is also an officer of the Knights Templar of Canada and a member of its Grand Council. He's a very high-ranking Templar in this world. Here is what he said, that Daniel's familial connection enables him to explore the ancient mysteries within the Tree of Life and Veil templates and their connections over time to the Freemasons, the Knights Templar, and the Knights of the Golden Circle. Francis Bacon and the Rosicrucians, and Sovereign Grand Commander Albert Pike. Where he travels next, and this is, I'm saying this to you too, Daniel, don't stop traveling, will be on his personal journey of discovery will be the key, because you're close. I know it. You are close. And we're going to find out what all of that meant and what close means in just a second, Free Dreamlanders. Subscribers, just keep on listening.
Ever wonder what the Close Encounter experience is all about? Think you know what it's about? When you open Whitley and Ann Strieber's Immortal Communion Letters, you're going to experience a whole new vision. Not something being told to us by researchers and theorists, but the actual testimony of people who came face to face with this unknown. Unforgettable. And the book is only $3.99 at Strieber.com.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
The Afterlife Revolution is a work of love written across the bridge between the living and the dead, between me and my beloved wife, Anne. You can learn what it means to live across this bridge by reading or listening to the audiobook of The Afterlife Revolution. It's available in paperback, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook on audible.com, amazon.com, audiobooks.com, and wherever audiobooks are sold.
War Day changed the way we think about nuclear war. Communion led millions to realize that they had encountered the visitors. Superstorm gave a word to the world that has become the byword of our time. The Key is among the most prophetic books ever written. And where can you get inside the mind that created all this? On unknowncountry.com, where Whitley's life stories, his powerful meditations, his books, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, and others are available in audio format, and so much more exclusive Whitley Strieber material. Join Whitley on the path to tomorrow. How? Subscribe to unknowncountry.com today.
We're talking to Daniel Duke, Jesse James, and the Lost Templar Treasure. Marvelous, marvelous book. Really a lot of fun to read. Author danduke.com is his website. Now, we're going to get into, at this point, the Templars themselves and the connection. Can you give us, in a relatively clear way, how the connection between the Templar Treasure and Jesse James works? Now, I know it's a long story, and don't try to, just go ahead and tell it as best you can, and we'll work on it together as we go along.
Okay. Well, and as I'd mentioned earlier, when describing my mother, her aunt had passed on a map to her that had belonged to Jesse. Well, that was the one. You know, a treasure map is always going to catch someone's attention. It caught my attention right off the bat. Mom brought it home. You know, when I got home from school, from college, she showed me, and I just couldn't quit looking at it for days. But it had codes on it, and it was mysterious to me, which also drew me in deeper. But over the years researching that, you know, I came across the KGC. Well, the KGC, a lot of people claim they had a treasure template. Well, I got my hands on one of the the treasure template, which is passed all over the treasure hunting forums, or used to be anyway. And I got my hands on that, and I thought, okay, I guess he was KGC, and if he was, then this should help find the treasure. And, it didn't help right away. You need a scale. You need to know the scale of the layout, how many miles apart different treasures are, et cetera. And, it was very frustrating until years later. We were shown two locations where large treasures were recovered. And this was the lady who showed us was the driver for former Texas Attorney General Wagner Carr. And he had been talking to my mother off and on over the years about Jesse. And being an attorney general for the state of Texas, I had no reason to doubt his word. You know, that's pretty high up. So his driver showed us where the treasures were recovered. And that shortly, it was around the same time, there was a man named George Roaming. He was a Freemason. And when he was around 10 years old, he knew Jesse when Jesse was an old man. He grew up out in the same area, and his daddy was a farmer. They lived near Jesse. And Jesse
in Blevins.
That's right.
In Blevins. At this point, Jesse was now Courtney.
Exactly.
Right.
And so George, you know, when he was a boy, he would walk along the dirt roads going wherever he wanted to go. But when he would pass Grandpa's, we called him Grandpa, when he would pass Jesse's house, Jesse would often call him up. And during the summer, Jesse would, you know, sit on the porch with him and drink lemonade. And George told us a lot of stories about that, but that's off the topic for now. And to make a long story short, eventually Jesse trusted him enough to swear him to secrecy and hired him to help him load and move 680 bars of gold in a large dray, which was a large wagon, just a heavy-duty wagon. 680 bars of gold, and they took it, you know, miles away from their house. He said it took them all day to get there, where they were going. When they got where they were going, there were several men in a field, and they each of them had hired a young boy to dig a hole and bury the gold.
680 bars.
Exactly. Each one.
I mean, that's an immense amount of gold.
It was. He said each bar weighed around 15 pounds.
Well, where in the world could that much gold have come from?
He didn't know. He claimed he didn't know where it came from. When we asked George the same question, he had no idea. But he said there were more bars left in Grandpa's barn, stacked on the shelf and painted black.
My word. That must have really, really floored you.
Yeah.
And so what's been done to try to find him?
Well, he showed my mother and I before he passed away, he passed away in El Paso, Texas. George did. But before he passed away, he'd written a map on a piece of a brown paper bag from the grocery store. And, you know, he drew the map out in front of us and told us, this is where it's at. I want you to tell me if you can find it. So I did my best. It's under a lake. When I told him it was under a lake and on right, I believe it, well, it's under a lake and it's on government property now. But I told him that, and he just shook his head and gritted his teeth. It disappointed him that it was under a lake.
That's a funny thing that would end up under a lake. You have to wonder whether or not somebody who built the lake, because folks, just in case you don't know, Texas has no natural lakes. All the Texas lakes are man-made.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Texas was, what it used to be said about Texas was that God finished creating the world on the seventh day and looked around and took one look at Texas and said, well, you know, I'm going to have to create some very special people who are going to want to live in this thing. And it created us as kind of people who can stand to live in a place that just is not real pretty, let's face it. I love it, though. I think it's very pretty. In any case, Texas, no natural lake. So how did that lake come about?
It was built by the Corps of Engineers, the Army Corps of Engineers.
When did that happen?
I wish I had the date. I believe it was the 1950s. 1954, for some reason, comes out. I would have to double check that.
You know, it's a funny thing, isn't it? The fact that the government property figures prominently also in the mother lode story, which we'll be getting into in the next segment of Dreamland about Victoria Peak.
Yeah.
But let's just go try to circle around this thing a little bit more as to why it would be that the Corps of Engineers would choose that particular spot. Is there any obvious geographic reason for it? Or,
well, there was a confluence of I believe it's the Leon River and Cow Creek, which is a pretty large creek. They met, and just downstream from where those two met, they built the dam, and it serves to, provided water for Temple, Belton, and I believe Killeen.
Yeah. So, in other words, it's a logical spot to build it.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. There's no. We're not looking in any deep conspiracy theories here. Just a logical spot to build a lake. By the way, in case you don't know it, all those old dams they built back in the Army Corps of Engineers built back in the 50s are in danger and need to be replaced. But it's going to have to be the state of Texas that pays for it. So watch out if you live downstream from any of them.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, there's one of them already collapsed in north of San Antonio and drained a lake that was surrounded by million-dollar homes, some of which were owned by people I know very well, and now they're living on a kind of swamp.
Oh.
So, okay, now, we're going to get a little bit deeper into this story. This, you understand, folks, this story has got layer after layer after layer, goes all the way back to the Knights Templar. And I think to start sort of excavating a little deeper here, let's go to the College of William and Mary and to just exactly why that is important. Daniel, can you tell us exactly what role the College of William and Mary plays in this whole story?
That was one of the... I still get excited when I think of that. As I was researching the treasures and what was formerly called the KGC template, I noticed there was a second template involved. But before I even discovered the second template, I'd read about the Bruton Vault at Bruton Parish Church in Williamsburg, Virginia. And when you're researching treasures, that one came up quite a bit for me anyway. And I thought, well, that's interesting. Then I went on, I kept pushing it aside, but for some reason it kept coming back into my circle of research. So I couldn't help but, it kept popping up and I had to look at it deeper. So I found a book written by Maria Bauer. She was the wife of Manly Palmer Hall, who was a famous Freemason and author and lecturer. Well, I read the history of it, the history of the college, but Maria Bauer's book had, she'd mentioned a vault, a hidden vault with treasures of great importance and wealth and knowledge that was hidden away, and ties with Francis Bacon. It was an incredible story. Well, people didn't believe her that there was a, people didn't believe her story. And she had proven that the church building, the original foundations weren't, she knew exactly where the original foundations were through code she had broken in her research, and they didn't believe that. Well, she proved them wrong. So I thought if she was sure about that and used the same method to find the original foundations, then she must have been, it added to her credibility on the vault, which was very near to that, within feet. But she started to excavate for the vault. Something happened, and she was, that was put to a halt, and they didn't let her continue her dig. And I thought, well, that sounds even more suspicious. So it kind of piqued my curiosity. And in the meantime, I had known about Victoria Peak through legends, and I'd read about it, and that's in New Mexico. And I thought, I wonder how far apart these two places are. And I got on Google Earth. They're 1,715 miles apart. And I thought that number, it keeps popping up. Reading about Williamsburg, 1715, came up a lot. I mean, and it was the year 1715, for example, was the year the first Masonic Grand Lodge in England was erected or formed. But that dealt with, Freemasons and England, and I thought there's not much of a connection there, so I went on. I thought that originally. So I got to looking deeper into 1715 and its connections with Bruton Parish Church or Williamsburg or anything. I found that the building of William and Mary College, the original building, is 1,715 feet away from where the Bruton Vault is supposed to be. And I thought, boy, that's a little odd. And, as I researched, that number kept popping up in different places. And I thought there's more to 1715 than it, and I need to look into it, but I didn't know where to begin. So I'd put that off to the side, and I would research other things. There were so many. When you're researching a story this big, it's like it's got fingers, and they kind of go off into different paths, and then they come back together eventually. But and it tends to confuse a person unless you just sit back and give it time to all soak in and then return to it later with a different perspective or from a different angle. And so that turned into I was reading Morals and Dogma by Albert Pike, General Albert Pike, He was also the 33rd degree Grand Sovereign Commander of the Freemasons. Well, he mentioned Kabbalah, Gematria, which is a form of, it's not numerology. Gematria is like numerical values to Hebrew words or any word in any language you're using. But it started, I believe the importance in this lies with the Hebrew words and their form of gematria. Or that's what I concentrated on, because Albert Pike had written about it so much. And he'd also written a lot about the Tree of Life. So I got this, over time, in several years, I started piecing it together. And I tied in the line from Victoria Peak, New Mexico, to Williamsburg, Virginia, at the William and Mary College and Bruton Parish Church, to different known locations, like Georgetown, Texas, 12 miles from me, where one of the treasures was recovered.
How interesting. I know Georgetown very well personally. I didn't ever know that, though.
Yeah, it was recovered in the 1980s. It was a very large treasure. That was one of the ones that Wagner Carr's driver had showed us.
What did it consist of?
According to her, it was she said they loaded truckloads of gold out of there. A man was operating it. He was getting the gold out of a cave that was there, and he was smelting it and selling it on the black market. She contacted the Texas Rangers, and they took care of the rest of it. They put a stop to that and recovered the gold, according to his driver.
Because at that time, it was illegal for Americans to possess gold.
I believe so.
Yeah.
So she, I think what, at that time, I also think my theory on that was that the man was selling it on the black market because he didn't want a red flag with the IRS or something like that. And he was, that was just my theory on that. But in the 80s, they recovered that. And lining that up.
Then gold was not illegal for Americans to own at that time. I stand corrected. Go ahead.
That's okay. And that site, or the main line from, I call it the main line, it's from Williamsburg to Victoria Peak. And then I drew a line from there, connected Georgetown and other sites, and it formed a Tree of Life template, which just, I was amazed by that after reading Pike's Morals and Dogma and, looking at his version of the Tree of Life verse, it all started falling into place. And I thought, okay, either I've gone insane or I've come across something very huge. And that ties in with the Veil template, which I had formerly thought of as the KGC template. After checking into it deeper, it falls in perfectly with the Tree of Life template, because in the Kabbalistic beliefs, there are associated with the Tree of Life, there are three veils of negative existence. And there are three veil template sizes. There's a large, medium, and small. And they all tie in, and they cover, they serve as a covering, a veil, literally and figuratively, as the veil for the Tree of Life template.
Ever wonder what the Close Encounter experience is all about? Think you know what it's about? When you open Whitley and Ann Strieber's Immortal Communion Letters, you're going to experience a whole new vision. Not something being told to us by researchers and theorists, but the actual testimony of people who came face to face with this unknown. Unforgettable. And the book is only $3.99 at Strieber.com.
Listen to some words from one of our longtime subscribers.
As a subscriber of Dreamland for many years, it's been an incredible adventure and truly a Rosetta Stone for so many of the experiences that all of your listeners have had. Please join us. It's a fantastic ride. But I will say that certainly Dreamland does reflect something that I've always known, that man's mind mirrors a universe that mirrors man's mind. And no other place will you get this truth than on Dreamland. Come join us.
Some of the most thrilling, mind-opening interviews ever recorded are in the Dreamland Archive. Open your mind to Sir Lawrence Gardner's brilliant vision of the past. Listen to Russell Targ's phenomenal insights about ESP. Be inspired by Dr. Eben Alexander's stunning near-death experience. Listen to an actual recording from a plane as it was attacked by a gigantic flying disc. Be transported to a new level of inner grace with Whitley Strieber's meditations. Enjoy The Communion, Transformation, Majestic, Secret School, and Superstorm audiobooks, and so much more. The UnknownCountry.com subscriber section. As little as 10 cents a day. Priceless. War Day changed the way we think about nuclear war. Communion led millions to realize that they had encountered the visitors. Superstorm gave a word to the world that has become the byword of our time. The Key is among the most prophetic books ever written. And where can you get inside the mind that created all this? On UnknownCountry.com, where Whitley's life stories, his powerful meditations, his books, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, and others are available in audio format, and so much more exclusive Whitley Strieber material. Join Whitley on the path to tomorrow. How? Subscribe to UnknownCountry.com today.
Okay, free Dreamlanders, on that note, it sounds like it's time for you to contemplate these messages. We're talking to Daniel Duke. His website, authordanduke.com, his book, Jesse James and the Lost Templar Treasure. And you know, most people do not buy the book when they listen to one of these shows. They listen to the show and that's enough for them. It's not enough in this case. You can have a lot of fun with this book on a whole lot of different levels. Number one, it's an incredible adventure story. Number two, it will convince you that Jesse James did survive and did live in Texas under another name. And three, you're going to get just enough information, just like I did, to think to yourself, well, maybe I ought to take a look out there for some of these treasures. Maybe I can beat Daniel Duke at his own game. Well, just before we left the air, you were talking about the Kabbalah and the parts of it that may serve as a kind of decoy. What did you mean by that?
Well, there's two templates that I discovered. One was the Tree of Life. The other was the Veil template. Which I had formerly referred to as the KGC template. But after ruling out the involvement from the KGC, in my mind, further research in Kabbalah and mysticism, various forms of Kabbalah, I've come to believe that it is representative of a veil that covers the Tree of Life template.
And now, what is the significance of the Tree of Life in connection with all of this treasure?
Oh, that is okay. Let me just. Well, I was going to quote from Albert Pike, but I don't have the quote in front of me. But I can explain it anyway. The significance that the Tree of Life had with this was when reading Morals and Dogma. From Albert Pike and other Masonic sources had mentioned the Tree of Life as well. Kabbalah plays a large role in a lot of areas of Freemasonry. So I took that as a clue, and I thought, well, let's just see how this works. So I learned as much as I could about gematria, Kabbalistic gematria,
which was very important in Francis Bacon's work.
Yes, exactly, and. I'm glad you pointed that out. With gematria, I also went through. I found some sources, different rabbis who wrote in English, and I could, because I didn't know Hebrew, who described gematria and their different beliefs, which also meshed well throughout my research with Freemasonry and other, Rosicrucianism, and those areas. Gematria is basically the calculation of a numerical equivalence of letters, and words or phrases, and they take the number of the word or phrase, and they break it down in various ways, and they tie in and show an interrelationship between words and ideas, and they tie things in. So you could hide a lot of code in that if you wanted to. That isn't, you know, I don't think that was the Kabbalists. It may have not been the Kabbalists' intentions, but it could easily be used to hide codes in. So I thought, okay, I'll keep that in mind and keep, you know, researching. And this took a long time. It wasn't all just in one day or night, you know, a quick revelation. It was a lot of research and reading and sitting back and thinking, and then it all clicked. Like, for example, I mentioned 1715 and how it ties in with the, you know, Bruton Parish and all that, and it's the length of the main column on the Tree of Life template. 1715, the gematria, well, it can be broken down as 5 times 7 times 7 times 7. Well, I thought, okay, 3 sevens, what could that mean Kabbalistically or in gematria? And I found out, you know, on the Tree of Life template, there are 10 sephirot, and each one, the plural, that's the plural name of it, is 10 little points on the Tree of Life. The singular would be Sephira. There's 10 of those, and between each of those, if you follow the path you're supposed to follow, you know, Kabbalistically through the Tree of Life, there's numbers on each path also. So that all adds up from top to bottom to 777. And I thought, okay, so 5 times 7 times 7 times 7 is how you break down 1715. 777 is part of it. What about the 5? Well, 777 means it basically means Tree of Life. The number 5 can be used as to mean it's a the gematria of the, like, the word behold. It's also used as a form of saying for the Hebrews, saying God's name. It's the numerical value of one of God's names. It also means behold. So it could be translated as behold the Tree of Life. And then all the other distances involved in the Tree of Life template. Like, well, there was that, you know, 1715, there's 548 and other numbers, and they all have meanings. Like 548, for example, is the distance from Victoria Peak to Georgetown, Texas. The two large treasures that were recovered. And 548 can be broken down into 4 times 137. Well, the number 4 it represents the word door in Hebrew, and 137, that's the numerical value of the name of the word Kabbalah. So if you look at it like that, I thought, oh my God, it's behold the Tree of Life, door, and Kabbalah.
You know something else about 137, folks? I am very interested in physics, and the number 137 is the most mysterious number known to science. It is 1/137th. It is known as the fine structure constant. It is a constant in the electromagnetic structure of the atom, would be the quickest way to explain it. And nobody knows why it is 1/137th. Except we do know this, if it was any other number, the universe would not work. It is essential, but its origin is unknown. The great physicist Wolfgang Pauli, used to say that this number was the link between the mysterious world of consciousness and the physical universe, and he became close friends with the psychologist, the great psychologist, Carl Jung, and they discussed and studied the number together. Incredibly, when he died, when Pauli died, he died in a hospital room in Switzerland, and it was room 137. Wow. So here we are, face to face with an extraordinary and very deep mystery. Now, where do we go from here on this really remarkable treasure hunt,
Daniel? That's a great question.
Yeah. I'm interested in good questions. I spent a lot of time thinking about them.
And I had read some about the fine structure constant, and that blew my mind too. But what you just said just added to that. It still blows. Now I'm just sitting here wondering where I left off.
Yeah, because here we left off with the number you were talking about, the various numbers, and the number 137 came up, and as the number of the Kabbalah, which is its famous mystery in physics, that the number of the Kabbalah would also be the fine structure constant. It suggests hidden knowledge from long ago about the way the universe actually works is hidden in the Kabbalah. And if there's anyone who would have understood something about that, it is Francis Bacon.
That's true.
So tell us a little bit about Bacon's relationship to this whole story. And folks, in the third half hour, we're going to New Mexico. We're going to Victoria Peak. We've only got a couple minutes left in this half hour, and then we're going to say goodbye to our free Dreamlanders. I'm so sorry. I miss you guys. But tell us just a little bit very quickly about Francis Bacon.
Francis Bacon was a genius, in my opinion. I don't think there are many people in history who could accomplish all the different things he's done. But the reason I came across his name was through Maria Bauer, who later became Maria Bauer Hall when she married Manly Palmer Hall, the Freemason. In her book, she had tied in the codes and linked the codes that she found to help her find locate the Bruton vault and the original foundations of the Bruton Parish Church. She had linked that back to Francis Bacon. And Francis Bacon, he had done so much in his life, but he was responsible for bringing these treasures, according to Maria Bauer Hall, and I believe it also, to America. He is known also as like the father of Freemasonry, or modern day Freemasonry anyway. And I'm starting to get excited.
No, that's okay. There's an awful lot here, folks, and we're coming to the end of the second half hour. I'd just like to say this, that the relationship between all of this and Manly Hall is absolutely fascinating, because if anyone knew the depth of these secrets, it was Manly P. Hall. I have read the book Secrets of All Ages. I've spent time at the Philosophical Society that Manly Hall founded right here in Los Angeles. I have a lot of friends who are deeply involved in all of that and in alchemy. And at the core of all of this is alchemy.
Yeah.
And an understanding of alchemy. And where have we gone in this hour from Jesse James not being assassinated by Robert Ford all the way to Francis Bacon, the most mysterious number in the universe, in physics, and the Kabbalah and all kinds of different places. And now we're heading for Victoria Peak in New Mexico, where all of this comes together in one of the most extraordinary mysteries you will ever hear about. We're talking to Daniel Duke, Jesse James, and the Lost Templar Treasure, Secret Diaries, Coded Maps, and the Knights of the Golden Circle. If you don't get any other book you've ever heard about on Dreamland, get this one. It is so very, very cool. AuthorDanDuke.com. Free Dreamlanders, thank you for being with us, and we'll be talking to you again next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.